Hey, and welcome to the Vergecast for the week of, what is the week?
January 30th,
2012. I'm Josh Topolsky.
I'm Neil Patel.
And we have with us a very special guest.
You can do this, come on, you can figure this out.
He's somebody who works with us, I don't know exactly.
It ends with a Miller.
Paul Miller, everyone.
I have
just
to say.
Kidding. Just kidding, it's Ross Miller. Ross, say hello.
Hello.
We're very excited. Paul's out, and frankly, you know what?
He's out for good.
I'm glad.
Do you see?
I prefer this Miller.
Chris's full quote. You know,
by the way,
nine
out of 10 people prefer Ross Miller.
We've discovered our Millers are interchangeable.
This is very true.
Kind of awesome.
What does that mean?
It's just Chris's pull quote on the post, on our front page.
Oh, that's good. That's really good.
Actually, true story. I got Paul Miller's seamless web order delivered to my apartment the other day.
What was it?
I was Senior Pollo. They actually thought I was that.
What was the exact order, though?
I don't know. I didn't need it.
Maybe you don't know what was in there?
I was checking.
It's making me hungry.
Senior Pollo.
Whatever you're talking about.
I mean, he is named Mr. Chicken.
For God's sake. Can we turn Neli down a little bit?
I would love to be turned down.
They sound a little loud. He sounds a little loud in my headphones. On. That's disgusting. You're a married man, almost.
6 months, dude.
He's very, very loud in these headphones.
5 months.
Can you turn him down?
5 months.
Can you mute Neli Patel in my headphones? Headphone one, kill Patel.
I think
Anyhow, so this is the Vergecast, by the way, in case you're wondering what you're watching. This is the Vergecast, where we discuss the weekend consumer electronics technology, technology culture, consumer culture, technology culture.
I think it's just culture.
Consumer culture. We're discussing the weekend in technology as it relates to culture and culture as it relates to technology.
That's deep, man.
You're damn right
it is.
And
relations is a thing.
And it's been a very interesting week.
It's been a week of not gadget news. You know what? We've been talking.
Which is just fine as far as I'm concerned. No, I saw enough gadgets at CES for the next 6 months.
I saw enough.
I'm all set.
Chinese Android tablets at CES.
I'm all set. I bought three of them.
No, you know, it's like we've been having this bigger conversation about what technology news is as we launch this site and like build it.
What is it?
Well, it's not things that turn on anymore. It's like not things with LEDs.
Speak for yourself.
Yeah, but like Facebook doesn't have an LED.
Well,
you know Facebook needs an LED, I have to say.
One thing that was missing from their IPO filing was that any indication that they were going to give us an LED notification light.
Yeah.
A Facebook light. Not a bad idea, actually. Like a little accessory. It's just like a blue light that goes off. Blue light special.
Look, I'm sure Facebook there's a Kickstarter notification. On right now. Someone's doing this on Kickstarter.
Kickstart's happening.
You need a column. It's just like random ideas you've had called Kickstart this.
Yeah, that's actually a good idea. Just random stuff I thought of.
Speaking of which, the biggest news of the week was the Facebook IPO.
Yeah, we should just jump right into it.
We should go for it.
So Facebook did their IPO filing.
So there is some business news this week.
Yeah, I mean, here's the thing. We're at the Verge. We're exploring. We're expanding. Where we want to cover everything that seems relevant, and that every day is like we're finding something new that's relevant. I think we've done a lot more web coverage, a lot more social coverage, and stuff like Web 2.0. Is it still 2.0? It seems like it would have gotten an update at this point.
I will say the Web 2.0 stuff. I would say that is over with the Facebook IPO filing.
It's now just web.
Well, it's the web, and it's okay.
World 1.1.
This whole idea that. Facebook is, I think, in many ways, like the paradigmatic Web 2.0 company.
Check it out, your fancy word.
I'm a fancy words guy.
Mr. College.
College. You know, I should have dropped out and started Facebook.
I'm like your, like, brother who didn't go to college, blue-collar worker.
So, man, you
listen to Mr. College over here.
Yeah, my blue-collar worker brother who was a, like, charted European music producer and is now the editor-in-chief of The Verge. Really, man.
But that is true. But
that is true.
But anyhow, but yeah. No,
but in many ways they are. But it's over. Like that whole idea that there's a new this wave of invention that's new.
Yeah.
It's
well, that's not over. We've entered a new era. I mean, I know what you're saying. But you're not saying like it's dead. You're saying it's very much alive. But it's gone from. And we were talking about this that it's gone from, this kind of like nerd culture and a hacker culture and I think this goes for everything that's happening in technology right now. It's going from, but we've talked about this a bunch, but you're saying it's kind of graduated.
Yeah.
And when I tweeted about it, I said the internet graduates. And it is this feeling of, here's this thing started by this kid in a dorm room. He's still very young, and this is now a real, this is a real company.
Yeah, he's 25. Like, that's nuts.
They were waiting until he turned 25. I mean, this is a real, it's a real company. It's a real industry. You know, what they do is going to be relatively important over the next 10 years, so.
10?
20? I don't know. What do you want from me?
I think if they're a generational company. I think they're going to be around. We always talk that Google is the internet. You know, Facebook is the internet.
I don't want Facebook to be the internet. I really don't, and I'll fight that tooth and nail because it would make a terrible internet. No, I'm sorry. I was there. I was on Facebook today trying to change something. I don't know what it was. One minor setting, and it's like a sea of, it's a maze of death.
It's a
Philip K. Dick.
But what's going to happen to your Farmville if you don't?
Yeah, I don't play Farmville, so I don't have to worry about it. So actually, if I want to play a video game, I get a console out and play a real video game.
These are some interesting things that came out of
Farmville. I'm not casual about it. So
just the mechanics of what happened are ultimately quite boring, right? It's like Facebook handed in a sheet of paper.
Very boring.
And they said, we want to raise $5 billion. We think our valuation is going to be this. And they handed in another stack of paper, which is what they're going to use to sell their company to investors, like on the road.
And what was interesting to me was, like, you know, was almost like a qualitative evaluation of, like, what their strengths and weaknesses are.
Well, that's what you tell investors, right?
Right. I mean,
here's who we are.
It was very much like a Ross Miller email, and it had a lot of bullet points.
Super long.
And it, like, yeah, really broke down, like, every possible scenario. It is actually, like, in a lot of ways, I mean, I feel like you could have done a great filing for them.
I mean, my emails were lawyerisms at
home. When we do IPO, Ross.
You're the guy.
Every little nook and cranny will be covered.
I mean, this is an inside joke, but Ross has this... It's both. It's like a blessing and a curse that he's able.
It's mostly a curse.
Like when you're talking about a topic, like should we change the color of the review tag or what? It's just something really minor. And he'll send you an email. It's like 4 pages long with bullet points of like the pros and cons of why you might want to not change it. But our business could be hurt if these 500 things happen. It's like they lay out every possible scenario.
Well, I think that's what you have to do when you're trying to raise.
If the power grid in the U.S. goes down, our business could be harmed.
Right. So I think that. That's the stuff that was
interesting to us.
Like
normal.
The business part of the news, it's like they want $5 billion. They want a $95 billion valuation. But who cares, right?
Well,
people care, but...
There's shareholders care.
Yeah, but I'm not going to be... Sad. We're not allowed to invest. I think the problem with having a group of people who are not allowed to invest in tech stocks talking about tech stocks is that fundamentally I just don't care.
They don't mind it to other sites.
Yeah.
No problem over there.
I'm out of here, man.
See ya.
By the way, I've been a venture capitalist for the past
what?
Years.
What? Patel Ventures. Huh?
Yeah, PV.
It's on top of my head. That's just, I'm just you're
just riffing, man. Good. PV. No, it's coming.
PV.
So the stuff that's interesting is that they say things like Mark Zuckerberg owns 28% of Facebook. They list, because we have a CEO who owns so much of Facebook and makes all the decisions. You know, he could make the wrong decisions. That's something that they're worried about. But I think what's actually more interesting than Zuckerberg is how much importance they put on their COO, Sheryl Sandberg.
Yeah.
Who actually makes more money than Mark Zuckerberg.
She's a woman also.
She's a lady.
Yeah, are these figures accurate? 1.5 million versus 30 million last year? Is that right?
Yeah.
Wow.
She makes 30 million?
She made 30 million last year.
Well, but how much? What is her percentage of ownership?
It's not as high as Zuckerberg. So Zuckerberg's salary is going down to $1, but she's staying very high. I think that sort of stuff about this IPO is interesting. Like, that's the news that's interesting. Here's this company. Nobody really knows how it's been run. It is now, I keep saying, it's now among, it's in the upper echelon of American business.
I was most surprised to discover that, and maybe this was common knowledge, I don't follow their board that closely, but Reed Hastings is on the board.
Which
I didn't know.
Yeah.
The guy's rich. Reed Hastings really is so rich.
Right. Oh, and Facebook made like $1 billion last year in profit.
Yeah. Right.
It's nice. It's funny because listed off their profit and it was just $1 billion straight, like flat. Like they hit the number, like they're at the gas pump. They're like, that's enough.
We're done. But it'll be exciting to see this thing play out. But it is overall rather boring. I mean, it's interesting for us in a lot of ways, on a lot of levels, but it's also. Basically boring at its core.
I thought
it's business.
The business, that part is like, there's still so much to go for the business story to be interesting.
Yeah.
Like once they actually start.
I need a little more social network in this. Yeah. In this mix.
You need more like deep like Trent Reznor.
Be some like
tones.
Yeah.
Can we get a Trent Reznor tone?
I don't think they can.
Just dead silence.
They can't produce. They can't just like. There's no like. What do you think? There's a button in the control room, or they just have Trent Reznor town?
I don't know.
They
what
do
on
have
right
an
now.
Andy Samberg like soundboard.
I like that we now have a control room, and you immediately assume that because there's a control room,
look,
there's like a
let
sound
me quote
effects board.
Mark Zuckerberg. You know this quote this?
You play the sound of a toilet flushing, and then like a change, like the change sound. You guys have that?
What?
No.
I, what's like going a, on in there? We're spending all like this
a,
money.
How about like a car? How about like a car horn and then some like gunshot?
I will say that I do have a cough button now, so I can just click it.
Yeah, we can't hear you anymore.
I mean, I can hear you, but
what?
Endless amounts of entertainment.
Right.
Wait, is here. This gonna work?
Anyhow, but
hello. Oh, sorry, I'll stop. Can I say more stuff about Facebook?
Yeah, please do.
I totally lost my train of thought.
Okay, so now that...
Oh, two things. Oh. I remember what they were. Okay. The two things about that were really interesting. One is the letter Zuckerberg wrote that was all about the hacker ethos of Facebook and how they build it. And the second one was that 12% of their revenue comes from Zynga. Like, crazy Zynga games.
Sorry, I'm shooting camera one here. Like...
Can I read... I've just cut off Josh.
Go on.
Sorry.
I was waiting for that to happen. Like these buttons are very dangerous.
Go ahead. What were you saying? Sorry, please continue.
12% of Facebook's revenue comes from Zynga,
and that's not just the games. It's also the
well, they
ads.
Buy so Zynga buys some ads, but their total revenue comes from.
Right.
And I would imagine the majority of that 12%. Something's happening between Josh and our producer right now that I don't understand.
Something great.
Creighton is like in this crazy
what's
alluring.
What's going on? You tell me.
I think everything was fine.
Everything is fine.
Now I'm interrupting the podcast.
Yeah, yeah. Please stop doing
can
that.
You, could you go?
I told you you could talk.
Can you go get me that toilet flushing sound, please?
Yeah, can you work on the car horn toilet flushing?
12%. You know what I'm saying? Zynga?
Zynga. Mm-hmm.
And the letter that Zuckerberg wrote, which you actually covered.
Yeah.
I think those are the two most interesting
things. So we were all scrambling, like, looking through this document. There's a letter in the middle of it that's Mark Zuckerberg's, like, impassioned description of what he wants to do. My favorite part of it is that he refers to relationships, human relationships, as a fundamental unit of society.
Yeah.
Which is like, what is a unit of what?
Of society, a society unit.
A society unit. Like this is definitely going to be a new Zynga game, right?
Yeah, society
right.
unit.
Society unit?
Yeah.
Society unit hero?
No, I've been grinding away at society unit.
But, I mean, to him, it's like these people are like little nodes. Like, well, Nodeville. It's like these little
ooh,
tally
Nodeville.
Marks.
Nodeville.
Nodeville.
I'm going to do that so Zynga can copy it tomorrow.
I just think it's funny. I honestly think that, you know, Facebook's stated mission is just total BS. I mean, it's like
you think so?
We're in a social mission. I mean, I think there's some real problems, and we've talked about this before, but, you know, part of their mission statement is, like, we think, like, authentic identities are important so that you can act the way you do in real life on the internet. And it's like, well, the internet wouldn't exist if people acted the way they do in real life. Like, that's what's so great about the internet.
Right.
And I don't want the internet to be a place where I am who I am all the time on the internet. Like, I want to have parts of my existence that are just for the bedroom or other areas, like the floor of the bedroom.
Ooh,
or against the wall in the bedroom.
To the wall.
The point is, I want to be able to do what I want to do
down.
When I want to do it with whom I want to do it and not have it be exposed to the world.
I'm just going to press the like button on that one.
Because frankly, it's illegal.
And disturbing.
And I could be arrested. No, but you know, it's like I don't agree with Facebook's philosophy of like authentic identity. And like, there's a bunch of other stuff I don't agree with. But like, you know what? Advertise to me all you want, but like, don't force me to like into some weird social construct that you think is like the way it should be. Because like, I don't think Mark Zuckerberg knows shit about human interaction or reality.
Yeah, I've been saying this for
like I don't want my like interaction with people online to be dictated by a guy like Mark Zuckerberg, who I'm sure by the way is fine and we'd love to do an interview with you, Mark, whenever you want.
Well, you know, what's funny is that he is the king of Facebook.
You know,
right?
Why?
And Facebook is like an alternate society,
you know,
that
I want to pose a challenge to Zuckerberg. You're happy to sit on stage with Walt Mossberg and Kara Swisher. Why don't you man up and do a real interview with me? I don't know what that means. Their interviews are great. And also, like, they give him, like, the worst. Like, yeah. They rake him over. Stop moving that thing over there.
I can't.
They
help
rake him over the coals, so I don't know what worse I could do.
Yeah.
Bring it, Zuckerberg. Yeah. Don't you want to see me and Zuckerberg talking?
I can see you just, like, slowly increasing the temperature of the room just to get him to the same kind of
I don't have to increase the temperature, man.
You're just going to?
Just give him a look.
That look right there.
That's it.
All right.
How do you feel right now?
A little more intensity. Yeah. Burrow that frog a little Furrow that brow. There you go. Mm.
Burrow that frow. Is that what you just said?
You've only had one beer. It wasn't even a full. Anyhow.
It's been a long day.
I know we were talking about something.
Yeah, burrow that frow, dude.
Burrowthatfrow.com. Is it available?
Not anymore.
Burrow that frow. Also, using different spellings could have totally different connotations.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Anyhow, so I was just complaining about Facebook. Yeah, back to you, but... Patel.
No, and I think the other thing is that the we were talking about this hacker ethos.
Yeah, but the hacker way.
The hacker way. And they put it in the filing. They said, we build our company.
Yeah.
We're using it the hacker way. We think this is how you run a company now. And I think that's really interesting. I mean,
sandals for everyone.
To tell your investors, like, we have a $100 billion company. We'd like $5 billion of your money. By the way, we're going to do it this way. Like, here's how we run our company now. Here's the way that we're building value. And it's by being hackers, right?
Yeah, right.
However that works in a big company, a huge engineering company. Because I don't think they're all hackers. I don't think they're all hacking away.
Like, I think there's probably doing some whatever they want managers over there that aren't.
I think they have some management.
Yeah, and I know that like they have an open office, but they probably have some private offices too.
Right. So I mean, I just think it's that. That's what this is to me. It's not about the money. It's not about the business. It's about this type of company now being one of the biggest and hottest companies in America, right? And it's in the conversation with Apple, Microsoft, Google, GM, Exxon.
Somebody said something in our comments I thought was pretty funny. You know, they were like, didn't Pets.com IPO as well? And, you know, it is true. Right. I mean, I think it was Pets.com. I mean, there were a bunch of those, like, the initial, like, the bubble, the bursted bubble. Is that doesn't sound right to me.
The bubble that burst.
Anyhow, but like there were like Facebooks of their era. You know? I mean, there weren't.
No, you know, the thing is that Pets.com was like never profitable.
They were successful ever.
Right. Well, Facebook has $1 billion.
It's very successful. I mean, the one thing that
that's 845 million.
No, the one thing that the internet clearly learned is you wait till you actually have a real company before you file for IPO.
They had a sock puppet.
No, but you know what I'm saying.
Really
like, I do think, but it's like it'll be interesting to see where Facebook goes from here. I mean, if their goal is to become the internet, that's going to be an interesting one to watch because that will not be an internet that I want to participate in.
Well,
and I think
that,
a lot of other people will feel that way.
What was that piece from a couple years ago that Zuckerberg was like, I want to be the new Google. Like, I want people to find their stories from Facebook.
Well, I think that's already happening. I think that's what Twitter wants too, right?
It is very much happening.
I mean, the question on the internet has always been, look at all this stuff.
How do I do anything here?
Yeah, you know, and it's the question for... you know, a computer too. It's like, how do I get the apps that I want? And you see, like, now people are discovering that people, they want choice, but they only want a limited amount of choice.
Yeah.
Right? And Facebook provides you with a limited amount of choice.
Coke and Pepsi. I will say, well, do they, though? They don't provide you that limited amount of choice. I mean,
it's a limited amount of choice because all you see on Facebook is what you've chosen to see. It's what your friends like.
Whoa. It is interesting, though, that we have, discovery is still not really, there's really not a lot of ways to get to things on the internet. You've got a few main ways to do it.
Right.
We haven't built elaborate systems of truly intuitive discovery.
Well, you know, what I think is really interesting about is that that's kind of where the money is, right?
Discovery.
It's being the middleman. You think the Discovery
Channel would be more popular.
Well,
that's a terrible joke.
Extremely popular.
Please forgive me for that.
Shark Week, dude. It's not going anywhere.
That is, Shark Week is a big deal.
But the middlemen are popular, right? Our company is still trying to figure out how do we make primary source content like really valuable all the time.
Yeah.
But it's Google, you know, and part of it is, well, we got to be on Google.
Right. I mean, it's
algorithms.
It's curation versus creation, and curation right now is just a better return on investment, but you still need the creation. Right. Why are we here?
That's a good point.
Well, creation costs money, and curation is like...
Oh, it costs a different kind of money.
Yeah, but it's like engineering
monopoly money. Like
it's more upfront money. How do we make the curation effective? But then you just kind of let that go and get
the machine.
Right. The creation.
You build a machine.
Yes.
Right.
That's a terrifying conversation.
I don't really know what you're talking about at this point, but what I will say is, there does seem to be, though, a kind of not a lot. I mean, it's weird because Facebook is not that good of a discovery tool. I mean, it's good, like, because if you discover stuff through your friends, and then it's like a very narrow field of discovery, I mean, in my opinion. Twitter presents a more open field of discovery, but it still requires you to like. But Twitter doesn't like. See, Facebook.
I disagree with you.
Well, Facebook to me requires social connections. Like it.
But it doesn't because you can subscribe to people now.
Yeah,
but
now you can subscribe.
How
to people,
well is that doing?
Yeah,
though?
It's not really. That's not the main. But like becoming friends with people is like what people do on Facebook, right? Mm-hmm. And they see stuff in their feed from those people.
Yeah,
I think that. You know, it's actually asking you to form like a bond with a person, whereas Twitter is just asking you to like see that they are saying something.
Right.
So like it's a much more passive experience, which I think makes discovery easier because I can follow somebody that I don't necessarily want to be friends with, but I may be hesitant to be friends with somebody. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, no, interesting.
So, I mean, they're two very different services. They're not even in the same world, really, when you think about
it. But I think Facebook is the more... Ultimately, the more powerful of the two.
When are we going to see Twitter games, Zynga, on Twitter?
I mean, if I'm Twitter and I'm looking at 12% of my Facebook's revenue comes from Zynga, like the next company I'm calling is Zynga.
What would you do? What would they do on Twitter?
Who knows, man?
Like,
I'm not even sure that's what they even want to do, because was it Jack Dorsey at All Things Media this week? This week was like, you know, Twitter's a broadcast medium. It's the next radio.
Yeah.
Or something.
And then weird. And then Neil... Young said piracy is the new radio.
See,
there's so many new radios. You know what else is good? Just the radio. It's quite entertaining.
When they said Neil Young and the thing, I could have sworn it was like, this could be Angie Moco's Neil Young. It's not going to be Asian rock star.
Oh, really? You didn't think it was Neil Young?
I swear to God, I was like, it's probably not. I didn't even think about it. I didn't even look at
it. I didn't even think of it the other way, which is funny. It's like an age thing.
That's terrible.
Yeah.
You want to talk about another company that's going through big changes? Are we done with Facebook?
I think so. You can friend us on Facebook, by the way. We're all on.
Congratulations, Mark. You got richer.
Zuck. Zucked up.
What does
Zucked up? Wow.
It's pretty zucked up.
Let's talk about Sony.
What do you want from me? Let's do talk
Sony
about Sony.
Zucked up.
Ross, talk to us about Sony. You love video games.
I love video games. They're the best ever. Video games.
You're a big fan of video games.
Is
that true?
I play every now and then.
I hear you go down to your local arcade and put some quarters in slots.
You know, little quarters here and there.
The problem is he's not putting them in the Sony machines.
Sony arcade machines?
That'd be awesome.
I can just see my eyes just light up. Like,
why don't they do that? Why don't they have, you know, when are arcades going to come back into fashion? They should.
They aren't.
They need to have an experience that you can't get at home. Motion-controlled gaming.
In New York, that is true. You cannot get that at home here.
It's too small. You don't have enough room. You're like,
let's do it.
For $1, you can get a working Kinect
space. Tell us about Sony.
I want to turn my elbow keeps hitting my wall.
I'm putting this back on the rails.
Go ahead.
So the big deal, we heard this rumored about a month ago, I think, give or take, just before CES.
Yes.
But Kaz Hirai is basically taking over as the head of Sony.
CEO. And Stringer is going to be the chairman.
Which is... You know, whatever.
I mean,
Eric Schmidt is the chairman.
Do you think this is Torsten Balsillie Lazaridis movie?
Well, you know, he's saying all this crazy... what was his quote? I think he gave a quote to Wall Street Journal. He's like, I thought turning around PlayStation would be my hardest ever challenge, but oh, damn.
Or no, it was like, holy sh... And then like...
Yeah. Yeah,
really?
He said holy shit.
Holy
it's okay.
Sh-
we swear on the podcast now.
We do?
Oh, we do?
You've been swearing on the podcast every week.
Every once in a while, I'll drop an S-bomb or something, but...
Or, you know, a Z-bomb here.
I'm not trying to make...
Mother Zucker.
Ooh. No, you're fired.
Goodbye.
Anyhow.
Let me read this exactly.
So let's talk about Sony, can't we?
Oh, here we go. Second draft.
Well, no, so, you know, he has his plan. Mm-hmm. You know, his plan is very dry in terms of plans. Like, we've got to be better at digital imaging. We have to play to our strengths in gaming. We have to turn around the TV business.
It's very boring.
And we have to create new areas of innovation.
They just have to find a way to make money.
Yeah.
If they're not making it, and make more if they are.
Yeah.
Pretty much. But I mean, the thing is, like, he recognizes, like, you know, cameras and gaming are where we're doing the best.
Can we talk about how bad they've been beat by Microsoft in like, the whole home?
Yeah, I mean, you asked about Thorsten Hines. It's like, the PS3 is great, and I have one. I use it all the time, but I use it to play Blu-rays.
I was just going to say, I actually have not had mine hooked up, and I'm going to hook it up so I can watch, because I just got the new Star Trek Next Generation Blu-ray in the mail, which I'm pretty excited about. And I was like, well, I guess I'm going to have to hook up my PlayStation 3 now so I can watch I was also just getting a cheap Blu-ray player because...
But Uncharted is, like, great. I mean,
Uncharted's amazing.
Their franchises
one of the best
are
games
good.
Ever. Well, you know, they're few and far between, man.
Yeah.
I mean, that's
but I mean,
the thing,
they're getting the same like flagship third party titles, like these AAA titles.
But you know what, Microsoft, like on the home entertainment piece, just destroyed them. Like,
oh yeah,
it's kind of like a real FU to the whole Blu-ray HD DVD battle. You know, it's like, okay, how's that going with the Blu-ray stuff? Pretty good. I guess the HD DVD attachment didn't really work out for the
anyone.
For the Xbox,
I still have mine.
I have mine too. What? Someday, man, it's gonna come back.
Well, I mean, like, it's my only copy of Hot Fuzz, my only copy of Children of Men.
Dude, I have Blade Runner HD DVD. Oh, what am I gonna do? What am I supposed to do with those?
But which cut though?
I have the box set with everything.
And then you have to keep it.
I know. I also have like a bunch of stuff I bought on HD DVD, like when it was on sale. Like, I'm gonna watch this, and they're all shrink wrapped.
But they're like $1 a piece.
I should get that out.
Well, you know, I continue to believe that like the Vita, for example, is like, it's a great idea. It is a limited idea, right? It is 10 people.
I think it's a turning point. Was that turning point before the Crest? It's like, this is the best gaming portable you're going to get. And the next generation, it's all mobile. It's all phones.
It has to be all phones.
It does, yeah.
I mean, there's no way that it can be anything but
phones.
It just
seems to me like if Apple, for instance, not that they would.
Built the PlayStation Vita?
No, if they just decided, like, we're going to make an official, like, controller adapter for the iPhone. The Vita would not have, it would be like, its purpose would be totally obviated. Like, you wouldn't be like, I got to get one. I'm just saying, like, if there was a standard that people gathered around it, I mean, because it is what would you rather carry with you? Your phone and a thing you put on it to play games, or your phone and a big game console as well? I mean, look, I hear you. I'm getting a Vita. Don't get me wrong. Yeah. But like, we're special people.
Yeah.
Who are like willing to do that.
I'm a venture capitalist.
You know,
PV, right?
Patel Venture Capitalist.
PVC.
Oh, that's bad.
His pipeline of
not
cash.
Plastic.
Pipeline of cash.
The PVC pipeline. Wow, everyone's going to be doing it.
I was going to say, like, you could do ads.
God, I have to register.
with PV, you could do, like, an ad for yourself where it's like, change your point of view, Patel Ventures. The POV.
Some atmospheric, not Floresque music behind you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's like a close up on Eli, like panning across his eyes, you know, and then like panning down the side of his face.
Kind of going sideways.
I'm just
kind of
back.
A bit of a wide shot. So
it's like shadowy,
not coming across.
Anyhow, so Sony, Kaz.
So Kaz comes from the
yelling things out. PlayStation.
Kazrod comes
Vita.
From the.
Go ahead.
I could start doing this too. Kazrod comes from the PlayStation section, which was formerly before him Ken Kutaragi, which. You know, way back, if people remember that years and years ago, just, like, completely botched the PlayStation 3 launch.
Yeah.
The PS3 is now not doing that bad. I mean, obviously, they don't have the same momentum, but it has turned around.
It has. No, it has. And I use it. Like,
yeah.
But I only use it to watch videos. I rarely use it to play games.
Anyway,
that's
I used it to watch Sunday Ticket.
From a branding perspective, from a managerial perspective, he was always the heir apparent.
Mm-hmm.
I am going to miss him because he's not as much fun on stage. As Howard Stern. You and I have done that.
Yeah, we've done Sony Live Vlogs for years now.
They're the best.
Come on. Isn't that his line?
Yeah. No one claps. He's like, oh, come on.
You could do better than that. He's like a plumper. He's like a plumper him. Rupert Murdoch.
No, he's not that evil. He's
no, no, I know. He's a little
evil. I could see him being evil, but in a very charming way. Like,
yeah.
Like, he looks like he could scare Will Smith on stage. And I think he did.
Smith was terrified.
The big
I think
hug.
Will Smith is probably just like, why am I, what am I doing at CES? How did this happen?
Yeah.
He's like, I made Independence Day. Why am I on stage?
Why are all these plump men and Dockers looking at me?
But he also made Men in Black.
It's because he made Independence Day. He's on stage there.
So Sony just lost a bunch of money. They lost $1.2 billion. For the quarter.
Siphoned up by Apple.
I mean, they have a long way to go. And that their TV division is lost, basically. It's adrift.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They have to prove a lot in mobile. You know, they keep talking this big game about phones. They bought out Sony Ericsson. They haven't proven it. I don't think the phones, like the Xperia Ion that we saw at CES is like, it's just another nice Android phone.
But here's my question. Like, they owned Sony Ericsson now, I guess is the way you could put it. For how long? Like, at what point do we start seeing the fruits of that labor?
Well, their challenge is to be integrated. You know, mm-hmm. Sony's biggest challenge has always been...
You mean like the PlayStation phone, the...
Well, the PlayStation. Well,
not, what is it called?
The Xperia Play.
Xperia Play. I forgot the name of it.
Sorry, well, I have a kill
it's
switch.
It's beyond enabled. That. It's you say kill switch enable. Is it kill switch engage?
Which thing engage. It's yeah, engaged.
There's
no point to reference them here.
Yeah.
Go on.
But no, their challenge has always been, well, we own a movie studio and a record label. We make phones and TVs and Blu-ray players and the PlayStation. And
they're like Microsoft. It's like
they make, and it's like, well, their challenge is to make that all work together.
Right. No,
no, like, matter like, what operating system.
I'm saying
runs.
Like Microsoft, and they still aren't there, but they've gotten better where the stuff is. Actually,
at least they're gluing the same UI.
No, I mean, like the phone and the Xbox have an actual like element of interaction now. You know, sure, you can't game between the two, which is would be a killer feature.
Right.
Like a killer feature.
Do you think, I mean, Sony could get there. They're closer to that.
I mean, Sony could get there, closer, but their, whatever, this Xperia Play offering has not been.
I mean, like, so the thing is, it seems to be they're doing a little more of a step up. So the big thing about Xperia Play was that it had a PlayStation Suite, which is like their Android version of a PlayStation Portal.
Right.
And they did nothing with it. And like now the Xperia phones coming out all have that. It's always Sony phones.
Maybe that's Kaz's like lasting contribution is that he used the PlayStation guys, so now PlayStation will be everywhere.
It would be nice because that was like the good idea. I remember when they announced that and the Vita, then the Sony NGP at the same time.
Right.
They put all this money in Vita. It's not doing that well in Japan anymore. Like it had a great launch and then it's just tanked considerably.
Right.
Maybe it's because people figured out that they don't really care that much about portable gaming.
Not for $30 games, no.
Right.
Right.
I mean, not when you've got iPhones and Android devices. I mean, honestly, I was playing Dead Space yesterday. I keep bringing this up. It's seriously, like one of the only good games on Android.
Well, that came out on iPhone first.
No, I know, but I was playing it on my Android phone. Mm-hmm. And I have to say, like, the experience is pretty good. I mean, the controls aren't great, but once you start to get the hang of them, I was legitimately scared by some of those four-legged creatures.
Legitimately scared.
Yeah, no, I was like scared that they were gonna pop out from somewhere like a console game.
And there's a couple of really good parts at the beginning, like it's psycho trippy, where like the room starts caving in.
Yeah, don't ruin it for me.
Not ruin it. It's like 5 minutes. But anyway.
But all I'm saying
is high quality.
It's good enough.
Yeah.
It's like it is like the, you know, the tablet app experience of certain things. Like Pages isn't as robust on an iPad as it is on a desktop. But guess what? It's good enough.
Mm-hmm.
It's the same thing. Like people. Don't require. They really aren't that picky when you get right down to it. Like you give them like a decent experience with a bunch of other great stuff, like they'll be happy. They don't. Most people don't need to have like the most awesome portable gaming experience of their life.
Right.
And that's where Sony has a problem because they've made the most awesome portable gaming experience that you can have, but there just isn't a big base for that at this point.
Right.
And there would be if the iPhone and Android devices didn't exist.
Did you play with it at CS for real?
The interface is horrible. Yeah. The interface is really bad. Like bad, stupid bad. Yeah.
Right. But I mean that said, the games are good. Like they're really good. They're better than what I've got on my iPhone, but they're not good enough that I'm going to spend a premium on them.
That's what
and
I'm
carry
saying.
The thing around.
No. Right. Well, but to me it's a living room device. If someone else is watching TV.
Yeah. That's insane though.
But yeah, exactly. Also, I have an iPad for that.
There's an iPad for that.
Yeah.
That's terrible.
Yeah, no, it's crazy. I mean, I just, you know, I'm not, I don't think it's all doom and gloom for Sony, but.
I think he has I think Stringer ultimately was a very entertaining CEO and someone that I will miss covering in the industry. I think ultimately he was a failure. I think he just failed to do a good job of running Sony.
No, he didn't do a good job.
And, you know, all summer long, all we talked about, and the thing about Kaz is, all summer long, all we talked about was PlayStation, like, utterly failing to hold that network together.
What's so crazy is that they had the console. Sony is like one of the major like content creators.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Microsoft has to go ask for content. You know, they don't make the content. And here's Sony with this huge like opportunity that they just couldn't put together.
His challenge is to integrate.
Give me a weird look.
Sony is really
good.
They're really precious about that content.
Right now.
And I think what they need to, you know, Apple isn't precious about content. They don't care if they make money selling music on iTunes.
I don't know about that.
No, they always say we run this thing to break even. They run iTunes, the content.
$93 billion even.
Well,
we say even, we meant profit.
But you know, if you look at the chart of where that profit comes from, it's the devices. Sure. It's not iTunes.
No.
They run iTunes because it helps them sell
a little profit.
Yeah, but it's it's a pittance, you know.
But they're doing better than breaking even.
Yeah, Sony runs like a Hollywood films, but it's like this much better. Like it's right. It's not really a big deal, you know, compared to what they make from the iPhone. Right. Sony runs a Hollywood studio that has to make a lot of money.
Yeah,
and so they're really precious.
And they can't do it.
They're really precious about the content.
They can't do it now that TOPE has been tabled.
Yeah,
they're totally
that's
doomed.
That's it, Rod. Sony's
they won't
done
be able to yeah, pay for it. Pirates of the Caribbean 6.
Pirates of the Internet 5.
Pirates of Silicon Valley, Valley 2.
3.
Tough is.
You just skip number 2, then.
Two happened in our minds and our hearts.
It did. It was I mean, like, that's the problem. Sony, like, you want them to go out and sell the content to the... You want them to use the content to sell their devices.
Yes.
But they won't do it because they're married to its production.
Correct.
And that's, like, that's why it's easier for Microsoft to be like, come sell your stuff for, like... 80 Microsoft points or whatever it is.
Are they isn't there some rumor they're getting rid of Microsoft
God,
points?
I hope so.
Points. Microsoft points are the worst thing that ever happened, are they not?
Yeah.
It's like that's 200 points. How many dollars is that? $1.57, really?
But
that's
think of all the people who have learned like, you know, mental math from it. Like we're
mental
really obscure mental math.
What is just, mental math?
Yeah, I'm reaching like, here. I
when
fully
you go to a sandwich at a bodega, it's like that'll be $3. You're like, well, that is 460 Microsoft points. Do you take Microsoft points?
Wait, isn't the other... No, wait. I don't even want to try to figure this
Excuse
out right
me,
now.
God bless deli grocery. Do you take Microsoft points? And by the way, that's a deli in my neighborhood, in case you're wondering.
It's like, great, no, but we take Bitcoin.
Great cheap that? Sandwiches. When I was broke...
Can
I used
to... Can we
get
some music for this?
There should be sad violin music, but when I did not have any money...
After all the sound,
not,
sound effects fine. Earlier,
you
not queued
any,
up now?
They, we weren't like, kidding.
They don't have sound effects, okay? They're not equipped to do sound effects. Anyhow, I used to go to this place, God bless, and get... It's where I would eat pretty much every meal, and they had like $3 sandwiches. And so whenever I was spending money on anything else, I would always just figure out how much it was in God bless sandwiches. I'd be like, well, $20, that's like six God bless sandwiches.
It's like measuring a marriage in Kardashians, like periods of 72 days.
No, when I was...
that's interesting.
My roommates and I used to... we realized that we never bought cereal. What's
happening?
I hear myself.
We're hearing Tomacco. Get that out of here.
Oh, well, the story's over.
you're so late.
I mean, it was going to sound great.
Good job, guys.
To the listeners, did you hear the violin?
Appreciate the effort.
Super pro.
That was awesome. Thank you.
But, I mean, can you cue up anything now?
No, forget it. Just go. Come on.
No, I was just going to say, my roommates and I, we would never buy cereal. So anything that was cheaper than cereal, we would just buy it. It's not, this isn't appropriate.
Turn this music off. We can hear it. It's good, though.
I mean, it was really nice.
That's nice.
Really sets the stage.
No, a minute late, but that's fine.
Cheaper than cereal.
We're going to get a sound effects board for you guys for here.
Just click.
Yeah, exactly. It's nonstop.
So this is turning into drive time radio.
All right. So what else do we have to talk about here?
There's a bunch of Windows Phone news here.
Yeah, speaking of Microsoft.
I made Ross memorize because I didn't want to do it.
And I didn't memorize, but I have it right here in like bullet
got?
Point
What's
format. In
Phone?
Detail bullet points. Excuse me. I had to get through all these.
There's actually a huge leak.
Yeah.
This video was like Joe Belfiore, like to partners talking about the future of the roadmap.
Right. So it's like it's basically detailing what Windows Phone 8, codename Apollo, is going to be. Mm. The key points about it, support for multi-core processors, 4 screen resolutions. We don't know which ones, but clearly they're thinking
they're going to get smaller.
Of a scale, yeah.
320 by 280.
120
be
by
awesome.
120.
Think even smaller. We need to go smaller.
But still 6-inch screens.
Yes.
Yeah.
Of course. Removable micro SD card storage. Thank God, finally.
Ooh. I mean, whatever.
It's a pain point. But
you know what? I don't need that. Just put more storage in your phones. Like, I don't care.
NFC.
Also, not really a biggie.
Well, it's going to happen.
I mean, further integration with Skype, which makes sense because Microsoft now.
I feel like we're years and years and years and years away from NFC taking any kind of real, like in America, at
I
least.
Think two
I can't.
Years.
I think you're,
you have a phone. Doesn't your Nexus have NFC?
Yeah.
Have you paid for cabs with it?
Do you have a Dwayne
No.
Reed?
Why?
Because I
Oh, because you have
even...
a Verizon one, right? Oh, and they
well,
burn
the one,
you.
The one in my pocket right now is a GSM. But you can
Why
install...
Why have you signed up for Google Wallet?
Google Wallet wasn't available on either one. You have to use the hack to get it.
It's not available on the GSM one?
Fine. Everything's fine.
What was that?
Don't worry, guys. There's a piece of tape holding a part of a cord.
No,
attached to a light.
Yeah, I was gonna say, is that,
Creighton
what
is
that cord?
Is going to be fine.
Hanging on to.
But no, but Google Wallet's not available on any Galaxy Nexus device that's that you can go buy. You have to download it after the fact, and you have to like do some. I forget. You have to go find the APK somewhere.
But anyway,
but like, yeah, I have it set up with like a $10 Google card, but I haven't had. I mean,
Start paying for those cabs, man.
Not getting my phone out and swiping the thing is not any easier than getting my card out and swiping it.
I disagree with you.
But you're wrong. You disagree all you want. I've been there. I've
seen it. Look,
you know how it's going to take off. It's going to be an Apple NFC chip if they ever do that.
That's right. Yeah. It's going to take somebody doing something that people want to make it that is good.
Right.
You know.
Well, the Galaxy Nexus is not the phone. It's going to take Verizon saying all of our smartphones have NFC.
Well, it's also going to take certain places. Like it's like the Container Store, Duane Reade. This is in New York, by the way, and cabs.
Yeah.
That's three pretty, well, not the Container Store.
I mean, you're
the Duane Reade and cabs is like, that's most of the money I spend in a day, like right there.
Yeah, I mean, you may be getting a lot more pharmaceuticals than most people.
Well, I do nothing but take cabs between Duane Reade to buy power.
I just think that we're just far, like if they did it for trains, that would be huge.
For trains, for Starbucks, for Walmart.
Yeah, for like
places. Starbucks will be there very soon.
Yeah.
The stuff they're doing with the apps, I mean, Starbucks is all about taking your money.
It's going to really, you know, possible. This is going to really be bad for Square.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Unless they do Square.
Do you know,
it would be good for Square.
We took a car the other day, and
a guy used Square.
And both of us were like, whoa.
A car service from Brooklyn used Square, and we were blown away. It was just so crazy to see anybody using it in that, especially in that setting, because they're like lo-fi.
Yeah.
Really lo-fi.
Did you tip them extra for the mind-blowing
event?
No,
he charged me 2.75% for the privilege of paying with a card. So
is that right?
He did not get an extra tip. No.
You tipped.
We tipped in cash.
I actually, you know, speaking of Square, I mean, it could just be the software triggered via NFC.
Wait. I mean,
if you had an
Square,
NFC.
Square is a platform versus a dongle.
Square, well, it is a platform, right?
Yeah, the dongle is irrelevant.
Right.
You know, the new Square app, you can just take a picture of the card. You know, the reader is irrelevant.
Ridiculous. Right? That doesn't even make any sense. But no, I know. But actually, this could be a big thing for them if people have open. You know, and if you can get access to the NFC chip,
right,
which is remains to be seen.
Well,
you can't just build anything you want.
This is like
NFC
Verizon.
Right now.
Verizon saying stuff like, "We have to make sure it's secure."
Yeah,
I mean, you should be able to just get access to it.
I mean, let's look at other countries. Like, I think Japan, like all their phones have NFC. A lot of people pay with those.
Yeah,
it was carrier mandate, like you're saying. So Verizon does.
Right. I like that. I like that Verizon is. They're not sure if they can get this, you know, it's like just use what they're doing in Japan. Just take that and it's pretty secure. They actually are using
years
it.
Years now.
Right.
Yeah, South Korea too, right?
It's there, yeah. I mean, and I think France is doing NFC stuff for the metro.
Theirs is weird because it's not straight to the metro. It's you have to tap your metro card to the phone to fill the card back up and then use the card at
the
station.
Dumb. That is impossibly stupid.
That's a horrible idea. Yeah. Like we're here though. It's NFC.
You have to.
I mean, it's gonna. I just think it's gonna be many, many years before it's in wide use.
2 years. It's gonna be the next generation of iPhones.
Okay, so that's 1 year until.
No,
it comes out.
Maybe.
So as soon as the iPhone 5 has it.
Well, they're not gonna put it in there and not do something with it.
Right, but
they're
I'm
not
saying,
just gonna be like it's got NFC capability. We hope people will take advantage
of it.
No,
they're gonna have to go to Visa and MasterCard.
Right.
And
right.
I mean, you're gonna have someone on stage go, and this is the guy from MasterCard.
Yeah,
he's
no,
going
exactly.
To tell you how awesome.
No, it'll be Phil Schiller. It'll be like, we have so and so from Visa
right.
here, right?
Right.
And then it's gonna be a carrier. It's gonna be, and I'm willing to bet it'll be Verizon that says we have a payments platform. All of our phones have.
So it's gonna be the Verizon's. What's the payment platform they support?
Oh, now? What's it? Oh, it has a name. Oasis. Yeah.
Because that's another format where we have to worry about which NFC.
Pando Daily. What's it called?
Pando Daily is a new technology website.
What's it called? It's driving me crazy.
It's definitely not Pando Daily.
I'm searching.
We'll just wait here while you search, Eli. It's no problem at all.
Hold on. We've covered this at length. It's driving me crazy. Do you stream now?
The silence is killing me. I hope it lasts.
ISIS.
ISIS.
That's like Pando Daily.
Isn't ISIS like the bad guys from, what's it called, the FX cartoon?
By the way, do you know Sneakers was on at 2 a.m. the other night, and I stayed up till 4 watching it?
Really?
The end. That's all. I just want to let you know that
I think we might be getting close to wrapping up this Vergecast. I have to say.
We have to finish talking about it.
It's pretty clear to me that we are running out of steam. It's been a really long week.
It has.
I always say that.
But we should finish talking about Windows Phone.
Can we? We begin talking about it.
Well, because you hijacked us with the Senate.
I didn't hijack it. I just said it was a long ways off.
Too many
Go
secrets.
Ahead.
Well, to be honest, that was probably more interesting than everything else I had to say about this. Windows 8 integration, Bill Fiore intimated that you could reuse, quote, most of their code when porting apps from the desktop to the phone.
Which they have to. I mean, if they don't that, they have failed utterly.
Right, because it's the same, like, Metro UI look, style.
Well, part of it.
Part of it. Here's a big thing. You can skin the camera app, at least the viewfinder part, which is as much as you can possibly get right
now.
Can't
you already do that on, like, the HTC devices?
No.
I don't think so, no.
Well, what's the skin the camera app?
Like, it's like you can make it look like what you want.
Wow.
I guarantee you that is totally driven by HTC. Because HTC is really big on
They're like,
the
can we skin? We want to skin the entire OS. No. What if we just skin, like, what if we just put our own, like, little, like, toolbar at the bottom? No. Okay. What if we do, like, a skinned version of the browser? No. Okay. The camera?
No, but HTC.
Okay, you can skin the camera.
HTC's doing all
Thank
that
you so
crazy
much.
Android camera stuff, right?
That's, by the way, that was Drew Bamford personally asking Steve Ballmer.
No.
Well, a very quiet, reserved Steve Ballmer going, no.
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 Yeah.
But, no. I mean, it could be HTC. It also could be Nokia going, we're going to put, you know, a bigger emphasis on cameras than everyone else is. We'd like to have more control.
I mean, like, we're putting a really good lens in our camera, so we want to put, like, a faux leather texture so that people would recognize.
You joke, but you know that's
so
the conversation.
So that people know how good. Look, your camera looks nice and everything, but it's just. You know, we really need to put a leather texture in here for people to understand how good the camera is.
It's a natural feel. It looks
it's
more
retro.
Yeah, it's retro. It's retro.
We're
gonna
do. We're doing filters.
But,
so,
okay, and then but Skype integration at the OS level is kind of nuts.
Yeah, just like they did with WebOS.
I mean, or
remember that? Remember that, everybody? No, you don't.
No one does.
It was awful. It didn't work. But you know what? But they had it, and they and if it had worked, that could have been a game changer. Just kidding. but it could have been, you know, at least something that would, you know, made having a touchpad worthwhile.
Yeah, but anyway, a lot of the other additions are like catch-up stuff, like data tracking.
You know,
support.
If it had made the touchpad good,
oh god,
if it had been really good, had just the exact same OS, but everything worked and was really smooth and fluid, that would have been pretty.
You know,
good.
This isn't just a show for the podcast. He really does walk around going, you know what, HP.
Oh, every day. I mean, every meeting starts this way. Let's talk about one more kind of big Microsoft story, and then we can talk about the peak being dead.
I don't want to talk about that. I want to talk about my BlackBerry editorial.
Yeah.
You know you want me to talk about the BlackBerry. No, we got to talk more about it.
All right, let me transition to the other Microsoft thing.
Great.
Do that.
What is it?
So, very quietly this past few weeks, Microsoft and Google have been in a gigantic fight. Over Google's new privacy policy.
It has been a big...
And it's really insane. It's like this slow burn of a fight. And it's kind of like Google doesn't know how to play. Because Microsoft does really mean stuff. They're doing really mean stuff. So the backstory is Google is changing its company-wide privacy policy. It's March 1st. All of Google's products will use the same privacy policy. There's a huge change within it, which means they were already, if you read all the individual privacy policies, they were sharing data across services, but now since a unified policy, they're saying, we'll share your, you know, what you search for on YouTube to influence your general search results, and what you look for, you know, what you read on Gmail, we'll use that data to influence our other products.
Did they say that? They'll actually use that data to do anything? I mean, my impression is that they didn't
Saying, Google has said to me, and I, you know, I've talked about it with them, I mean, they've said to me pretty directly, this is a no-change situation. What we're doing is we're making it simpler, we're making it easier for people to understand, and people are overreacting. Uh-huh. Microsoft has completely taken advantage of this. And people are, I think in some sense, they are overreacting. I think Google
is
trying to make it
simpler. Microsoft has been like...
They've been hammering Google on this stuff. They're taking out ads in like the New York Times. They're publishing videos with like evil. The Gmail man video was published today.
That makes me so happy because this got leaked back in like July
it was leaked,
or something.
Right, but they were showing it to like partners, right? Now they're like, let's screw it, put it out. And it's this video
hilarious.
Of this guy like reading your email as he delivers
the
it to
Gmail
you.
Man. You know, I have to say. So first off, we have hosted Gmail.
Yeah, they don't read that.
Has no ads.
Yeah,
and. I'm using Mailplane. I've turned the ads off. I mean, what are they reading my emails to put ads?
They're right, reading them.
And I don't see them?
Yeah.
I mean, a machine, which is not sentient, is reading them.
Not yet.
Looking for keywords.
Not yet.
And,
Well, look, I mean, this is
I've
a conversation.
I've seriously never even looked at an ad in Gmail.
This is a conversation that was being had on Gmail when it launched, right? Which was, they're going to read your email. And nobody cares. Ultimately, nobody cares because
well, I mean, I think somebody cares if, like, there's those emails are being sent to a room somewhere where some guy is reading through them trying to come up with the best ads to sell against them.
Well, if something, it doesn't matter who reads them to serve the ads. The trade-off is
I mean, they're still on Google servers. Google servers see them.
Right.
Right. But who else? I mean...
Well, no, but I mean, that's the question. Does anybody else see them?
Right. And that, but that's why the privacy policy is so important, like, ultimately. Right. And I think what's really interesting is that Microsoft has decided in the past week that the best way to engage Google directly in a fight is to say they're stealing your information and sharing it with other people. Whether or not that's true,
yeah,
they've decided that their best tactic is let's go after Google's weak point, which is their perceived evilness.
Mm.
Which is insane for a company that for so long has been the don't be evil company. And Microsoft has just decided. And they're doing a really good job of it, I think. And Google's doing a really poor job of deflecting it. Because I don't think they have any like sort of training or understanding or experience defending that particular
I mean, but to be honest, do you really think it's actually making any impact?
I don't think
you think
it
anyone's
is.
Watching an ad and going, well, I guess I better switch back I think to Hotmail.
People, well, it's scaring the hell out of Google, at the very least.
I think people see who... I mean, I think people who... are inclined to be scared, maybe scared, like old people. I think that people like us, I mean, I'm not saying that Microsoft isn't trustworthy because I'm sure they are, but they're about as trustworthy as Google as far as I'm concerned. Like, they're as trustworthy as any other major corporation that wants to make money off of me. And, like, let's make no mistake about it. What was that sound? Outside? Just an earthquake? Really?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, every major company that exists wants to make money off of me. They're either going to sell me something or use something of mine to sell me, like use information of mine to sell to have somebody else sell me something or like whatever. Like they want my money.
I mean, it wasn't long ago that Microsoft was the evil monopoly. People
yeah, right. No.
That.
I mean, like the idea that Microsoft is somehow this like wonderful, you know, open, transparent, nice company that doesn't want to like make money off of you
right.
is laughable. They're a huge company. What they're doing is, like, they're scared shitless that Google is taking their customers.
No, I'm saying,
you know?
That's what's
like,
really interesting.
It's the thing behind you. Sorry. Just kick that. Just
wow.
Gotta fix that. Can we get some, like, duct tape on that or something? Wow. Sorry, we have a loose connection.
I'm pretty
here.
Sure the earthquake that we just felt.
Hold on, let's
moving.
Take this off again. Take
that
your
was,
headphones
that
off.
That was
take
right.
your headphones
movement.
Off.
Good call.
That.
Is anyone in the podcast hearing that, or is it...
No, it's just us.
Okay.
It's just us. So our microphone amp has a bad connection.
Yeah, we have a bad cable here, and it's just caused some
And I'm pretty sure that truck rolled by.
That
and,
like, disturbed
and actually moved it.
Yeah, I might have, actually. Anyhow.
What? Wow, that was a real shock to the system.
Feels good.
I'm awake.
All
feeling
right.
a little more live right now.
Yeah, somebody give me a cigarette. Wait, what?
I think it's a non-smoking studio.
It's a non-smoking.
Anyhow, what the hell were we talking about?
Google.
Gmail man.
Gmail man. I was just saying that they're scared that Google's taking their customers, which they are.
Yeah,
they are taking their customers, and that's why Microsoft is out because people are using Google Docs instead of Word.
Right.
And that's upsetting to them, and they're using Gmail instead of Hotmail.
Right, but they're going completely on the offensive, saying don't use these, but they're not saying why you should use them instead.
I mean, I've used Hotmail.
Yeah.
It's not, it's fine. It's just not as good as Gmail, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Right.
And also, whatever. I'm not going to.
Also, Microsoft reads all my email.
Yeah. I mean, I don't care. It just, you know, honestly, I'm very satisfied. And by the way, I've written recently about Google's privacy changes. And,
yeah.
You know, I appreciate that there's like a legitimate reason to be suspicious of any major company.
Well, dude, this is the same thing. Google is the internet. So when right. Google changes its privacy
policy, I'm more upset and concerned with the search changes, and I think they're really stupid. And I think that that they're going to get dinged for it by the government, and I think they have a responsibility, unfortunately, for who they are to not interject search results with like Google Plus stuff.
Is this the search plus thing you're
talking about? I just think it needs to get, first off, it's not useful. That's number one. Like, I think at the core of it, it's not, it doesn't improve my search. It actually makes my search worse because I don't want to see what my friends have shared about Britney Spears when I search for Britney Spears. I want to see Britney Spears nude pics. That's all I'm looking for.
And every time I search for something,
does it help me if I see like that somebody's listening to a Britney Spears song? Right. That is not relevant to my interest.
It's actually funny because every time I search for anything tech related, Google image search, I'm looking for something or Britney Spears nude.
Yeah.
I find your picture comes up in the top row of Google images and your friends like these images.
Yeah, right. It's stupid. It's so stupid. Like, so first and foremost, it has nothing to do with my privacy or like, you know, if they're being fair to Twitter and Facebook. It has to do with like the search results are worse. And that's like Google's job number one, like on the search page, is give me good search results. Like, if you don't give me good search results, I will happily leave your search engine for one that gives me better search results. And by the way, don't be confused about this, Google. You are one better search engine away from being obsolete. Just the way Firefox was one Google Chrome away from being obsolete.
Right.
And like the truth about technology is you're only as good as your last idea. And like the one that's better from somebody else, like no one cares. They're happy to jump ship. Right. It's easy to download a new piece of software. And, you know, and it's easy to change your default search engine.
In many ways, Microsoft's biggest problem with Bing is that they've been too afraid to try something new. Right, Bing looks like Google.
Yeah.
Like ultimately, it is Google search.
If somebody could prove to me that search results are better than Bing, and also if it could become like I'd say 400 times less ugly, like it is the ugliest.
Oh, it's the worst.
The ugliest service. Yeah. I mean, so ugly. Even from Microsoft standards, it's ugly. That logo is the worst. It is the worst. It is so ugly, so badly done.
Yeah.
Like it looks like it was done by a 12-year-old who was using MS Paint for the first time. It just is, it's not that bad, but it is pretty awful. But like, here's the thing, Bing's fine. I think actually it's a fine search engine. I just wrote a thing in Washington Post, which is like, if you hate Google and you want to switch to something else, here's some alternatives. And it was Bing, DuckDuckGo, Blecko, and Wolfram Alpha, just because like, for like getting raw data, I think it's really amazing. But, and they all have really great, there's some really great stuff going on with all of the search engines. None of them are as good as Google. But if any one of them were as good as Google and I knew it, I would be happy to use it instead of Google. And that's what Google really needs to know. So like, it's the Search Plus stuff isn't upsetting because my privacy has been invaded or like Facebook has been dissed. It's upsetting because it doesn't produce better results. And if Google can't keep producing the best search results, they're in real trouble, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Because that's their bread and butter.
That's what I'm saying. I mean, Microsoft, they just need to try something. They can't copy Google and do better.
No.
Also, I don't think that's workable.
I don't understand their offerings. Like, what is my Google? I'm a regular consumer. I want to have, like, documents online. I want to have a calendar. I want to have email. Like, what is your product for that?
Google or Microsoft?
Microsoft. I know what Google's product is. It's Google.
Right.
It's Google Docs, Google Calendar, Gmail.
I mean, Hotmail does that stuff. It does email.
What's the Docs part?
I know what the Docs. Office 360.
365.
Yeah, or whatever.
What is that? Do I have to pay for that?
No, a lot of it's free.
A lot of it's free?
Yeah, you have to. There's stuff you do have to pay for.
Well, that's like the thing. They're not.
Let's do some online shopping.
But
no,
Italics? But to their Gmail man ad, like, explain to me what their offering is so I can leave Gmail, like, because I don't understand it. What I'm saying is, like, maybe that's it, but they're not making any clear.
Oh, it's a free trial.
Oh, okay.
You're kidding me.
Free trial. Well, I'm not interested because I don't want to pay for your service. You know what Google does?
This looks like a TurboTax page.
Here's the deal. Let me see it.
Oh, my God.
It's really bad.
Yeah, it's terrible.
Look at that. Microsoft, no one's going to use Office 365.
So here's the deal. Here's the deal. Google and I have a good trade going on. This is why I like to use their service, right?
I have to use Silverlight.
Oh,
God, there's a Silverlight update.
Microsoft,
I'm not watching the Office 365.
So I get good free services from Google.
Let's transition to plug-in free.
My payment, the way I pay them is that I let them read my emails and show me ads, right? Because I don't, but there's some percentage of users that will click on those ads, and they are able to make money that way.
Yeah.
So pretty good
trade. A lot of money.
Pretty good trade-off for a guy like me. I use the products. The products are good. They're updated often. They add new features all the time. They work really well. I mean, like, they work really well, especially for collaboration when you're doing doc stuff.
Yeah.
really well. The best collaboration of anything I've ever, best collaboration tool I've ever seen in my life is Google Docs. Like, multiple people editing a document at one time. Like, it's the most incredible form of collaboration online that I've ever seen, I think. Mm-hmm. Like, can you think of a better one?
Well, I mean, there are other apps that do it.
Yeah, Google Wave. I know there's other apps that do it, but the seamlessness with which it's carried out by Google is brilliant. Anyhow, the trade-off is they show me ads. Microsoft, first off, I don't know what your offerings are. Like, do you have a consumer-facing offering? Like, I'm not a business. I want to, like, do some stuff with my friends. I mean, I have a business, and I pay for Google Apps hosting and, you know, whatever. But first off, define your offering. Second, like, is your offering free? Oh, I have to pay for it? Well, I don't want to pay for it. I'd right. rather look at ads I never click. So how do you compete with that?
Right.
You don't. It's freemium.
I mean, it goes back to Microsoft's fundamental problem. They're an institution. Right. They work despite themselves. Like, their successes Windows is everywhere. Yeah. There's Netflix on the Xbox. That was the first one. It takes forever to get to it, but it's there.
It's better now. It's a little better.
It's gotten better. And you can do this.
I use Voice Bing all the time. I've been doing it nonstop.
Voice Bing?
Voice Bing.
I've been Voice Binging all the time.
Does Voice Bing search the web?
On the Xbox, no.
Not on the Xbox. Just searches your...
You use Voice Bing? I just got an iPhone 4S last night.
Really?
I've been trying to use Siri all day because I'm, like, excited. And no.
No, but I've been...
But you're in the living room screaming
at
the Xbox.
Really pissing off all my roommates. I'm watching Breaking...
because you talk too quiet.
I'm watching Breaking Bad, and I'm just screaming.
Siri, I'd like to make a phone call.
Siri.
You know what's really annoying about Siri?
What?
Is that... she doesn't know that I have multiple calendars. So I'm like, Siri, make me an appointment for tomorrow at 1 o'clock. She's like, you have 37 appointments. And it's like, but no, a lot of those are calendars.
Well, yeah,
that aren't my
calendar. You're not, Siri is for old people. Siri is for baby boomers.
Yeah.
It's not for a guy like you. I know they show a guy like you jogging. And he's like, oh, this busy guy.
Dude, I've been jogging all day.
But, you know, jogging stuff aside, you know, he's a busy guy. He's like, oh, I got to, you know, move my schedule around. He has 4 appointments that day, okay?
Yeah.
You literally have, like, calendars with, like, staff schedules, like, editor schedules, like, feature stuff coming in.
Yeah, I just wanted to look at my schedule.
We're really busy.
When you add something, does it know which calendar to go to?
It defaults, right?
Yeah, well, it will default to my calendar.
Okay.
But then, when I'm like, make me an appointment, she's like, you have 55 appointments tomorrow. And it's right. like... But all these other calendars to just let me track what's going on that aren't my calendar.
You know, your problem is you got to stop using calendars.
Yeah, just do
Anyhow,
something different.
But to Mike, what were we talking about? You were saying something about Microsoft.
I was just saying I piss off owners. I use the voice part of Kinect all the time. I've been watching Breaking Bad and just screaming Xbox pause, Xbox play, Xbox next episode, over and over again all week.
Terrible. Xbox, is he gonna make more meth?
Xbox, no. all right, let's just can we wrap it up?
You want to talk about your BlackBerry?
I want to talk about my BlackBerry editorial.
All right, wrap it up.
So I wrote an editorial about BlackBerry.
Another editorial.
And that's our. And
we
that's
should
our
have
show.
A stream of BlackBerry editorials.
I wrote. Chris wrote one a while ago. It's like
Joanna wrote one a while ago.
Did she?
Yep. We just keep. Jacob wrote one.
Dieter's on a couple. I think.
Wow.
We have now every Dieter wrote one. Every single human at The Verge, from the editor-in-chief to the intern, have now written impassioned editorials to Rim about how to fix the company.
It won't listen.
And no one listens to us.
My editorial was really actually wasn't that impassioned. It was just like nuts. It was brass tacks. I just think that their recent CEO change is kind of a smokescreen. I think it's just kind of BS.
Right.
And I think that they, you know, it's basically Lazaridis and Balsillie were like, you know, indignantly, how dare they suggest that we are not running this company perfectly? Fine, give these schmucks what they want. Give these idiots a new CEO, the puppet CEO of Torsten Hines. And, you know, go look at the leadership on the RIM site. It's like Torsten, which I believe is how his name is pronounced, Lazaridis and Balsillie, like on the same line. Like, there's no, it's not like CEO up here and these some little jerks.
No, I mean,
over here.
Essentially, they've added a third CEO, a third guy
making
directors, but it's
and
the same calls.
And he came out of the gate saying, like, basically, like, stay the course, you know, there's nothing wrong here, which is what they've been saying all along. And then he's backtracked and said, like, no, of course there's problems we're going to fix. But, like, it's my editorial was, you need to be, this is like, you got to be brash. Like, I think there's this belief. They're like, yeah, we're not doing well in the U.S., but we're doing better, you know, we're doing well in Europe and in Asia, developing countries. But it's like Nokia was saying that same thing. You're just like later in the curve, okay? Like,
oh, there's free Office web apps. That's what I mean yelled at. I don't want to.
You're being yelled at
that there are free Office web apps. Cool.
All right.
You have to use SkyDrive though.
I don't have to pay for anything.
I don't know.
But that's what I'm saying. Like, if this offering exists, like, make this a consumer facing offering that people understand. Like, they just want to sell it to people who buy Windows PCs. And they're like, hey, did you know you can get Office online? It's like, that's great. But what about for the rest of the world that doesn't want to use Office, that isn't using a PC that has Office on it? Like,
well, I don't know. Like, I'm watching a video of a woman using OneNote, okay? And that's what's happening.
I know OneNote, but okay, anyhow.
Torsten.
Anyhow, so I just think that, you know, they're saying what Nokia was saying a few years ago. And Nokia is making Windows phones now.
I've been saying RIM's gonna be making Windows phones forever.
They'd be better off making Windows phones than, I mean, that's what than they what they're doing do. Right now. Mm-hmm. I just think, like, people are like, you haven't seen BlackBerry 10 yet. And it's like, what is BlackBerry 10 going to do that Android doesn't do, or that the iPhone doesn't do, or that Windows phone doesn't do? And by the way, those all do basically the same thing. So what is gonna be like the killer edge? Better security? BBM? The stuff that no one really cares about at this point.
Android apps.
I mean, they're doing this thing with the playbook. Like, they should abandon the playbook right now. Yeah, they should really not spend any more time making playbook.
Okay, I'm not going to back down from this. They should let all that shit go and make Windows phones. Like, it's bad. The playbook is bad. It was bad from the start.
Hey, playbook 2.0 is a whole new ball game.
It's going to keep being bad.
I mean, here's
no
the thing.
One cares
this
about
is
it.
Like, this is
it
the
has
thing.
No cohesive app development strategy.
This is the thing. Let's talk about RIM for a second. Like, let's talk about the playbook. Like, you know, you made some mistakes. Let me tell you about your mistakes. You released a product that was supposed to represent the next generation of what you were doing, and you didn't include your most crucial key elements in that product: email and messaging. You've been boasting about your security and your speed of email and your great messaging client, and you release a flagship tablet product that was supposed to represent the next stage of BlackBerry's evolution with no email on it. And it's like, how bad are you at your jobs? Like, this is crazy to me. It'd be like if we put out the site with no news. It would be like if The Verge is here and it's just a product database and a forum,
yeah,
and it didn't have any of the news piece, right? Like, that's what, that's like, would, like, why would we do that? I'm just saying, like,
I'm not gonna, I mean, and we've seen that too.
I'm just saying,
I think we know how that goes.
Well, I mean, but that was what we did news. No, but I'm saying we did news.
Well, don't
right?
look at me that way, Creighton. Look, it's a stealth burn, and
it's not a burn. I'm just saying that we do news. I like doing news. Oh, like this whole team.
This person's like, what you did without any nudes, and that's also
that ain't news. That's true. No, but I'm just saying, like, as a parallel, like I think that I excel and our team excels at, like, producing news content, and the other stuff is like it. There's like a connection. There's like a connective. That, you know, the connectivity amongst those things is like what makes the site great, I think. But, like, I wouldn't take one of those big elements out and say, like, it's here. Like, here it is. Like, it's bad. The news element. Like, their news is email. Like, that's their core thing. Like, email and BlackBerry Messenger is, like, their core, like, what they want to tell you, right? They were like, hey, we have Flash apps. You know what? Take 5 seconds of the development of your Flash app engine and put an email client on your device. Because, mm-hmm. And then it's like, this is just for people. It's again, like, and it also falls in line with what I said in my editorial, where they just want to sell to people who own BlackBerries. They just want to keep selling to their fan base. That they did that with the playbook, where they were like, well, you have a BlackBerry phone. So,
yeah.
But no, the tablet market isn't based on, like, what phones people have. It's based on, like, I want a tablet because it's a new thing and they're cool and they do special stuff. So just, like, it's like, you think it's, like, a little, you made some mistakes.
Yeah.
You totally boned what you're supposed to be doing.
Right.
And it's aggravating to watch them act all nonchalant. Like, yeah, you know, we're going to get, you know, we're going to get on
Windows
course.
Phone. It's your only option. They have to make Windows phones.
But
they have to go to enterprises that they sell to right now.
I mean, Nokia did the same thing. They just kept going, like, Symbian is great and our next phone is going to be awesome. And just wait till you see
Windows phone.
What was the version? What was the last version of Symbian? And they were like, just wait till you see this. I remember. And what was the phone? It was like the they released a phone where it was like, we have a touchscreen keyboard now. And remember, they
and Thomas Ricker called it herpes.
Yeah, they didn't want to use capacitative displays.
No, but I'm definitely going to search in Gadget for herpes.
They wanted to use resistive.
Oh, syphilis. It was syphilis.
I was like, we didn't tag it herpes.
I think it was syphilis.
They have a new search.
The point is, like, you can talk about how great your past successes are until you're blue in the face, but that doesn't, again, with technology, like
N97.
N97. I remember they had a huge marketing push for it. They were like, this is the next generation. We've done it. That's BlackBerry 6, BlackBerry 7, and probably BlackBerry 10. I mean, but I'm waiting. I want to see it. I want to be blown away.
You know what else is free? Syphilis. And like the S65th operating system, it comes dressed in a beautiful package that drives you mad just as soon as you turn it on. That might be the best thing Thomas Ricker has ever written.
He's written some good stuff.
Yeah.
Anyhow,
the beginning of that is to Chris Sigler, my dear misguided colleague.
Oh, right, because it's our letters back and forth. That's great. Anyhow, long and short is I'm utterly uninspired by what Rim is saying and doing right now. And I think that the guy they put in charge, and you know, I haven't talked to him. They wanted him to talk to Crackberry.
Yeah,
but they didn't want him to talk to other people.
They called Crackberry first thing.
They called Crackberry first thing. It's because, you know, they want to sell to people who
rally
them.
The troops a little bit.
I mean, it's great. Yeah, but you know what? Apple doesn't call Mac rumors when they've got a new product.
They call Josh DePaul.
They call Wal Mossberg. And you know what? No shame in that game. He's been around a long time. He deserves it. He's earned it.
Yeah.
But watch out, Mossberg. I'm watching you.
I've been watching him for a long time, actually. He's really fascinating.
I've actually become pretty friendly with Walt.
Yeah.
Over the last couple of years.
Look, you're,
and I have to say,
you're the next generation of Walt, man. You're cranky.
I am cranky.
You're getting smaller with every passing year.
He's not tall, but but I do. I have to say, he's entertaining as hell.
Oh, he is.
You go to a dinner with Walt. He will get into it. He gets into it. He does not let people like you. If you want, you think you're gonna have a relaxing dinner with Walt Mossberg, it's not gonna happen. He will grill you. Anyhow, that's all I have to say.
Rim,
talk to me. I got some
Windows here. Funded.
Quit saying Rim. Quit saying Windows Phone.
It's gonna. Two choices.
You're like seizing on the.
Two choices.
Windows
Phone. Tizen.
No, they're not going to do that. That would be death. The two choices are they go out of business.
WebOS.
Or they do Windows Phone.
WebOS.
There are no other choices.
WebOS,
right.
Dude.
Yeah, it's open source.
Open source, baby. And yo.
Hey, baby.
It's awful. All right, we got to wrap up. That's the Vergecast for this week. My thanks to Neelai and Ross.
This guy.
Great. Thank you. Ross, great job.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Have you on here more often.
Good job for you.
You're one of the first that hasn't started crying.
Yeah. Do not cry. Do not cry on cue.
It's not over.
Do not
yet.
Cry. What's that? What is this? Why are you doing this? What's that? Creighton's going like this.
Do you have any music? Do you have any?
Oh, you want to roll out on him
you
crying?
You want me to cry again?
Can you cry softly?
Give me some music, and I will do this.
Can you cry softly while I do the outro? So that's our the Vergecast for this week. If you want to get in touch with us.
By the way, we've made so many requests of the
control
room.
Hold on. If you want to get in touch with us.
All we've got is Creighton looking at us like we're morons. And then some violent music 20 minutes late.
He's just, he doesn't want to show his disappointment to the team in here. That's why he's looking out here when there's no sound effects. That's the Vergecast for this week.
Why are you ruining the podcast?
If you'd like to get in touch with us, you can email us at podcast@theverge.com.
Wow.
You can leave a comment on the post when it goes up, or you can find us on Twitter. I'm Joshua Topolsky. Neelai is Reckless. Ross Miller is Ono Roscoe.
Sad.
Ono Roscoe, no E on the end.
Yeah.
Also, The Verge is @Verge. And we'll be back next week with more delicious, nutritious podcasts.
Maybe with Collins. There's a chance.
With what?
Collins. Phone calls.
I thought you were like naming somebody named Collins. Like,
no.
Who's Collins? Collins is in town. Nobody told me that. Potentially with Collins. We're thinking about doing live calls on the
Collins
next
is
one.
In town.
Yeah. Do you mind? That's the show. Rock and roll.
Oh! Woo!